If there is a forgotten American war, the Modoc War of 1873 may just be it. Even so, I'm sure that most of you are going to be happy to know that this will not be an annotated blow-by-blow description of that conflict. Instead, as much as possible, I want the onlookers and participants in that barely five-month conflict to tell you what they were thinking and what it meant to them. The Modoc War was the culmination of a clash between two cultures that rarely understood each other and, in fact, were unlikely to try. The Modocs ultimately lost not only the war, but also much of their culture and language and, at least for later generations, many of the original Modoc names. They simply vanished from memory. Perhaps, surprisingly to some of you, the military was among the least enthused about Indian wars. After all, they were the ones who had to fight them. General John Schofield, commanding the Pacific Military District at the end of the Modoc War, saw no rationale or excuse for the fight against those Modocs. He felt that the trouble could have been avoided if the civilian population had been just willing to talk things out. "The natural law of survival of the fittest may doubtless be pleaded in explanation of all that has happened to us," Schoenfeld said. "But that is not a law of Christianity, nor of civilization, nor of wisdom. It's the law of greed and cruelty." The scene of the action spans the California-Oregon border. Captain Jack's father and his people lived quietly on the shores of a beautiful body of water which was named Tule Lake, said Jeff Riddle. He was the son of Frank and Toby Riddle, who were translators for the military during the war. Toby was a full-blooded Modoc and a cousin to Captain Jack. You may know her better by another name, Wainema. "The Modocs inhabited that portion of the country known as the Lost River Basin. Perhaps it was 40 miles square, lying east of the foot of Shasta Butte," said Alfred Meacham, "sent by the government to negotiate peace with Captain Jack's Modocs. The Modocs themselves lived close to Tule Lake, but they also hunted into the lava beds far to the south and well east to Clear Lake. Oh, it was a territory that they knew very, very well." The war's roots lie in the increasing westward movement of settlers in the 1840s and 1850s, and ends with the hanging of 4 Modoc men. "This Friday morning was beautiful, a beautiful day," said William Turner, former editor of Jacksonville, Oregon's Oregon Sentinel newspaper, who had gone to Fort Klamath incognito, disguised as a teamster. Now, he would beat the competing correspondents to the story, and he would be the first to have his report of the hanging telegraphed to the nation. "Nothing particularly indicated it as a hangman's day," he said, "except for that scaffold, a sturdy and heavy framework of pine timber which stood with its 6 ropes dangling loosely in the fresh morning air." On October 3, 1873, Captain Jack, Boston Charlie, Black Jim, and Scuncheon John were hanged for the killing of General Edward Canby during a peace conference that was held at the edge of the lava beds in Northern California. The day before the hanging, the condemned Modoc spoke with military and civilian officials, and they were accompanied by reporters. "I wish for peace," said Captain Jack, but the young men said they were not ready for peace. Scuncheon John agreed. "Oh, there were some young men that were over rash and anxious to do something to distinguish themselves," he said. "Hooker Jim and some of the other boys made all the trouble, and when I look at these irons on my legs, I feel that they should be wearing them, not I." "I have heard the sentence, and I know what it is," said Captain Jack. "But I feel that I am more innocent than Bogus Charlie, Hooker Jim, Steamboat Frank, and Shack Nasty Jim. These were the men planned, instigated the crime of which I I am accused. You see, Jack had been hounded by Hooker Jim and the other young men to kill General Canby. They had called him a woman, wrapped him in women's clothing because he was arguing for peace. The majority of the men, young and old, thought that if they killed Canby, the general, the whites would leave the Modocs alone and allow them to remain in their homeland unmolested. Now, although Jack was chief, you have to understand Modoc leaders followed the vote of the people. It was, indeed, a true democracy. And to save face, Jack had agreed to the murder. Now, Jack had two other reasons to hate Hooker Jim. Near the end of the war, Jim had broken away from Jack's band and had actually helped the army finally capture Jack. Also, Hooker Jim was head of another small band of Modocs, and when hostilities began at the end of November 1872, Hooker Jim had made things worse by taking a few of his young men on a killing spree. Outnumbered by the Klamath Indians, Captain Jack had left the reservation in 1870 after complaining to Indian agent Orson Knapp that food was inadequate and the Klamath Indians were harassing his people. "When my people would go to get timber, the Klamaths would say, 'That is our timber,' Captain Jack said. 'When we went for water, they would say, "That's all right," but then it was, "That's our water." When we went to catch fish, oh, the Klamaths would say, "That's all right, but they are our fish." Agent Knapp was in no mood to listen to Jack. "You black son of a bitch," Knapp screamed at Jack. "If you come and bother me any more with your complaints, I'll put you where no one will ever bother you again." Captain Jack asked Bogus Charlie, who spoke better English, to translate for him. "Tell this man that I am not a dog. Tell him I am a man. Tell him that I and my men shall not be slaves for a race of people that is not any better than my people. If the government refuses to protect my people, who should I look to for protection? I am going back to my own country. If I stay here, I will be killed." Almost immediately, settlers began to complain that the Modocs were intimidating them and frightening their families. In early 1872, the settlers sent a petition to the governor of Oregon and another to the Oregon superintendent of Indian Affairs. They were demanding that Jack's Modocs, who had left the reservation, be gathered up and forced back. On April 3rd of 1872, Major Elmer Otis met with Captain Jack at the Lost River Gap near Olean, Oregon. "I was sent to this country to see what was the matter between you and the whites here," Otis said to Jack. "I've heard bad news about your young men going into houses where there was no one but women, 15 or 20 men all armed, and I want to know what you have got to say about that." "Who was telling you that 15 or 20 men of mine were trying to scare one man or even one woman?" Captain Jack said. "I don't want to say anything until I see the man who told you this. Then I will say something. I will tell the truth. What man was telling you this?" Well, of course, Otis refused to name names and would later meet separately with the complaining settlers. "All the white men, except Mr. Miller, say that your Indians come to their houses and frighten the men and women and make them give them flour," Major Otis said. Now, Henry Miller lived on the eastern corner of Tule Lake and said he was always leaving his doors open and was never bothered by the Modocs. He even hired them to help herd his cattle. When Otis asked Miller if he felt whites were in danger from the Modocs, Miller said no.
"I have Indians in my house," Miller said, and they have a key of my house and are herding my stock. Now, they've been all around me for the past 2 months, and they've passed backwards and forwards, and they live near me. It's not the headquarters, you see, of Captain Jack, but a number of Indians are living right near me."
Otis told Captain Jack that he hadn't come to take him back to the reservation, but he did offer a warning.
"If you should behave badly," he said, "we shall have to make war upon you. Then you're going to lose your women, all your children, and all your ponies. I'll bring plenty of soldiers, Indians, Paiutes, Snakes, Klamaths. They're all going to help me. And I will whip you all. What do you got to say to that?"
"You are not the first white man I ever saw," Jack said. "I have seen lots of white men before. I have known these people that live around here a long time. I never kill their cattle. My heart is straight. I talk to the white man, and I say, I don't want to kill you. You are a friend of mine for a long time. What will I kill a white man for? I can't eat him. I want to be at peace."
"You say that I'm not the only white man you ever saw," said Otis. "I know that you've fought them for a long time. Now you are at peace. And once you had a big band, now it's pretty little. That's the effects of seeing the white man and fighting with him."
"I wasn't here when there were plenty of Indians and when the war was going on," Captain Jack said. "You see, my people around me here, they have grown up since the whites came into this country." In the late 1840s into the 1850s, emigrant wagon trains traveling the Applegate Trail were often attacked by Indians. Because many of these attacks occurred near an outcropping of rocks on the shores of Tule Lake, that is now known as Bloody Point, settlers blamed the Modocs. Now, while their chief, now known as Old Sconson, a brother to the accused Sconson John, admitted that he had waged war against the whites, he did say, however, that some of those attacks had actually been made by other tribes. In November of 1852, in retribution for these attacks, a self-styled Indian fighter, Ben Wright, entered a Modoc village under a white flag of truce. Now, some say he was attacked first, and others say he had brought poison to kill the Modocs. What no one disputes is that Wright's men killed and mutilated at least 46 men, women, and children. Only 5 Modocs escaped, including Sconson John, who, 20 years later, like all Modocs, remembered Wright and his false flag of truce as they fought the Americans in the lava beds. By 1864, Chief Sconson decided that his people were being decimated in a cause he just could not win.
"Once my people were like sand along the shore," said Chief Sconson. "Now I call to them and only the wind answers me. 400 strong young men went to war with me with the whites. Only 80 are left. We will be good, if the white man will let us, and we will be friends forever."
Sconson signed a treaty, negotiated with Yreka, California resident Elijah Steele, in which they agreed to live in peace with other tribes and whites, that they would not get drunk or steal when in the town of Yreka, and would not sell their women or children to whites unless the man and the woman got married. The Modocs were still able to continue working for wages in town or at nearby mines and ranches.
"I've got faith to believe that this conference has saved the country a bloody war," Steele told the U.S. Indian Commissioner.
Steele was Indian agent for the northern part of California and one of many white men respected by the Modocs for his fair dealings. Within months, the U.S. government negotiated their own treaty, taking possession of Modoc land and requiring the Modocs to move on to the Oregon Reservation, where they were promised food, shelter, schools, and even job training. Even though the treaty wouldn't finally be ratified by the U.S. Senate until nearly 6 years later, Chief Sconson led his people to the reservation in peace. There, he would remain. but Captain Jack would not. Overall, the California settlers had little problems with the Modocs, and, well, although they didn't offer them equality, neither did they fear them or demand that the Modocs be locked away. It was the Oregonians, particularly the southern Oregonians around the city of Jacksonville, who insisted that Modocs at the very least should be closely guarded on a reservation or killed. This treaty would do very well if there was any security that it would be adhered to, wrote Orange Jacobs. He was then editor of Jacksonville, Oregon's newspaper. Experience has proven that the only proper way to manage Indians is to put them on a reservation in charge of an agent with a force sufficient to compel them to remain on it. The plan of making good Indians by hanging them is practical, but some faint-hearted people consider it unlawful and inhumane. When Captain Jack led his band off the reservation in 1870 and roamed at will from Yreka, California, to Tule Lake and beyond, the Jacksonville folk were upset. It will be remembered that this band is off their reservation contrary to orders, said a Jacksonville editor. Now, we think the authorities are remiss in their duty in not hunting this band up and taking them back to the place set apart for their keeping by the government. Oh, such a course cannot but result in more trouble. By the summer of 1872, the U.S. Commissioner of Indian Affairs, Francis Walker, in Washington, D.C., heard of the settlers' petitions against the Modocs and had received the advice of Colonel Otis and the request of Oregon's Governor Lafayette Grover that the Modocs be forced back to the reservation. Walker directed Thomas O'Neill, then the Indian superintendent for Oregon, to remove the Modocs to the Klamath Reservation peaceably if you can, but forcibly if you must. You will exercise your discretion about making arrests of the leaders, avoiding any unnecessary violence. O'Neill informed the military in the area, and the order trickled down until it reached Major John Green, who ordered Captain James Jackson and Lieutenant Fraser Boutel to bring the Modocs in. You know, I suggested to Green that there was no reason to believe that these Indians would not fight, said Boutel, and that the command he was sending was, in my judgment, altogether inadequate. Just enough to provoke a fight, in fact. Now, Green's reply was, if I don't send those troops, the citizens of Klamath Basin will think we're all afraid. They left in the middle of a cold rain and a sleet storm at noon, November 28, 1872. It marked the beginning of the Modoc War. There were three officers and 35 enlisted men in the company.
We were accompanied a part of the way by a party of citizens, Boutil said, who next morning engaged the Indians on the left bank of the Lost River.
They arrived in Captain Jack's camp near a sharp bend in the river early the very next morning. There were about 15 Modoc men suddenly rushing to arm themselves and form in a line against the soldiers, while their women and children sheltered themselves in their wickiups, lying flat on the ground for protection.
I moved down on the camp at a trot, Jackson said, completely surprising the Indians and creating great commotion amongst them.
It scared me, said Captain Jack. When Captain Jackson came and got there just at daylight and made me jump out of my bed without a shirt or anything else on, I hollered for them not to shoot, that I would talk.
I called to them to lay down their arms and surrender, said Jackson. Some of them seemed willing to do so, but Scarface Charlie, Black Jim, and some others kept their guns and commenced making hostile demonstrations against us.
Jackson told Lieutenant Boutil to take some men from the line and arrest the Modoc leaders if it was at all possible.
There's going to be a fight, Boutil told Jackson, and the sooner you open it up, the better.
The standoff didn't last long.
I am not a dog, said Scarface Charlie. I am a man. I am not afraid of you. Talk to me good, and I will listen. I raised my pistol and I fired at Scarface Charlie, Boutil said. At the same instant, the very same instant, Charlie raised his rifle and fired at me. Well, we both missed, his shot passing through my clothing over my elbow. My pistol's bullet passed through a red handkerchief that Charlie had tied around his head. There was some discussion after the war, after it was over, as to who fired that first shot. But neither one of us could tell who had fired first.
Across the river, the civilians who had approached Hooker Jim's camp, believing that they were helping the army return the Modocs to the reservation, hearing shots across the river, were suddenly taking fire from that Modoc band. "We were surrounded by Wickiups," said Oliver Applegate, "and the Indians, being under cover of camp and the riverbanks, had a great advantage on us. The civilians began a mild dash retreat. One citizen named Thurber was killed almost at the first fire." After less than a half hour of battle, Captain Jack's band retreated south to the lava beds. The soldiers torched Jack's village and unknowingly killed a woman who was lying on the ground inside one of the wickiups for safety. A Modoc baby was also killed, and the Modocs also lost one man, although Jackson, in his official report, would claim as many as 9 Modocs killed. Only one other Modoc was wounded. The army had lost one man and had 7 wounded. One of those would later die. On the other side of the river, with the civilians routed, Hooker Jim's band set off to the east to begin the killing of at least 14 male settlers. First were Louisa Bodie's husband, 2 sons, and her son-in-law. She blamed not the Indians, but the army.
"The Indians had told us time and time again," she said in a letter to a Jacksonville newspaper, "that if the soldiers came to take them upon the reservation, it would make them mad, and they would kill every white man. If the settlers had been warned, none of them need to have been killed."
Although told by the Modocs that they wouldn't kill women, Mrs. Bodie and her daughter feared things might get out of hand, and they rushed north to safety on the foothills of Stuckle Mountain. For nearly 2 months, the army gathered reinforcements and ammunition, while Captain Jack's people settled into the volcanic caves and pathways soon to be known as the Stronghold. Governor Grover immediately called for a volunteer force to cooperate with the regular troops. Jacksonville's John Ross, a volunteer general, with 2 companies of men, left for the lava beds just 4 days after the Lost River battle.
"My opinion," Ross said, "is if sufficient force is brought to bear and prompt action is taken, the war can be brought to close in about 30 days.
When they arrived, their optimism even grew higher.
"Calculations are to go after Captain Jack in 6 or 7 days," said Albert Fondre, an aide to General Ross, "and 2 or 3 days will probably wind it up for sure."
Well, optimism was rampant in the regular army as well. Colonel Edwin Mason arrived with 2 companies of the 21st U.S. Infantry, wearing a fur hat and riding a white stallion. It was winter. Snow was on the ground, and the muddy march from Roseburg through Jacksonville and over the Cascade Mountains had been very difficult. "I have no doubt but that we'll be able to capture Captain Jack's entire band if, and this is a big if they remain in place," he said. It was January 17, 1873. The army began its disastrous 10-hour attack. 400 men against barely 70 Modocs. Fog so thick that one could barely see a nearby soldier. Icy morning temperatures with snow and a sharp, jagged terrain. It all doomed that maneuver. Not one Modoc was seen or even killed. 11 soldiers died and 28 were wounded.
"In the opinion of any experienced officer of regulars or volunteers," said General Frank Wheaton, commanding the troops, 1,000 men would be required to dislodge them from their almost impregnable position."
Wheaton asked for reinforcements, but by the time they arrived, he had been replaced by General Alvin Gillam. In their rapid retreat, the army had left 6 bodies on the field, many wounded, and some scattered rifles and ammunition. When the fog began to clear, MODOK women and children began searching the battlefield.
"They found a few dead soldiers and also four or five dead volunteers," said Jeff Riddle. "They found 9 carbines, 6 belts, pretty well filled with carbine cartridges. They also found the ammunition scattered all over the ground, where the volunteers had made their hasty run for life."
Jenny Clinton, a MODOK girl about 11 years old at the time, and who would be the last survivor of that battle when she died in 1950, often told the story of that day when she was picking over the field for clothing and ammunition. In the stronghold, curly-headed doctor, a MODOK shaman, father-in-law to Hooker Jim, and one of the band that had killed the settlers, told the MODOKs that he would use his magic to protect the people.
"Oh, the white men cannot fight," he said. "I'll make a medicine that will turn the white man's bullets away from the MODOKs. We will not give up. We can kill all that come."
He ordered that a rope of tule leaves, hundreds of feet long, be braided, painted red, and placed so it surrounded the entire stronghold. He said no bullet or soldier could ever cross it. The Jacksonville Volunteers were disbanded and returned home within days of that first battle. The War Department in Washington, D.C. was surprised and concerned.
"Who had authorized these volunteers? Did anyone promise that they would be paid by the government?"
The department ordered the Army to submit
all circumstances connected with the service of these so-called volunteers.
Captain Reuben Bernard, a U.S. Army cavalry officer who had fought on the eastern flank during the January battle, dared to write a defense of the MODOKs to his commander. "These so-called murderers are fighting for their own lives and would be fools and cowards if they did not. For the gratification of a few cattlemen, land grabbers, etc., the MODOKs must kill and wound soldiers and citizens to twice their numbers, costing the government and private parties hundreds and thousands of dollars before anything definite can or will be arrived at. It seems cruel that human life should be sacrificed in such a manner for the gratification of a few unscrupulous dollar hunters." Now, believe it or not, Bernard was not disciplined, and he continued to fight the MODOK, retiring from the Army with the rank of general in 1896. General Gillam set up camp below the bluffs on the north side of the lava beds, overlooking Captain Jack's stronghold, and he placed Colonel Mason on the opposite side of the stronghold on a small rise called Hospital Rock. That was 4.5 miles to the east. Before another battle could take place, President Grant approved a peace commission, hoping negotiations with the MODOKs could still prevent a prolonged war. Captain Jack seemed willing to consider living on a reservation, end the war, and to make peace. "Oh, I will give up my home on Moss River," he told the peace commissioners in March 1873. "Just give me this lava bed for a home. I can live here. Take away your soldiers, and we can settle everything now. No white man will ever want these rocks. Give me a home here." Under tremendous pressure from angry settlers, the peace commission said that nothing could be done until Jack turned over the MODOK murderers of those settlers. But Jack refused. "Oh, let everything be wiped out, washed out, and let there be no more blood. I have got a bad heart about these murderers. I have but a few men, and I don't see how I can give them up." "Will they give up their people who murdered my people while they were asleep?" "Well, I could give up my horse to be hanged, and I wouldn't cry about it at all. But if I gave up my men, I would have to cry." Finally, on Good Friday, April 11th of 1873, General Canby and Captain Jack agreed to meet in neutral territory between their two camps. While returning from the stronghold the night before the scheduled meeting, Toby Riddle, who'd been carrying messages back and forth between the MODOKs and the military for some time, was stopped by her MODOK cousin, William.
"Oh, Cousin Toby," he hurriedly said, "tell them peacemakers not to meet them MODOKs in council. They will be killed."
Toby carried the warning back to her husband, Frank Riddle.
"I told the commissioners," Riddle said, "and I told them it was dangerous to go out there and to meet with them, and I advised them not to go."
But Canby waved off the warning.
"Kill us in the presence of 1,000 men? They cannot do it."
At a meeting of the MODOKs days earlier, Captain Jack asked his impatient young men to just give him more time. "I have a hard fight ahead of me in the coming peace councils," he said, "to save my men that killed the settlers, and to win my point to secure a piece of land in this country for our future home. But I am going to do it without any trouble." Black Jim jumped on a large rock and said,
"Jack, you will never save your people. You cannot do it."
Jim demanded that Jack promise to kill Canby. "Scuncheon John," he said, "had already promised to kill Meacham." When Jack refused, someone placed a MODOK woman's hat on his head and a shawl around his shoulders, pushed him down, and mocked him.
"You coward, you woman," they said. "You are not MODOK. We disown you. Lay there, you woman, you fish-hearted woman."
Jack jumped to his feet and threw off the women's clothes. This was a democracy. Majority did rule. Chiefs followed the will of the people, and no matter what Jack wanted, he didn't have the votes. "All that are in favor of me to murder Canby, raise to your feet," Jack said. All but 10 of his men stood up. A tent stood on a flat, grassy plain about 3/4 of a mile from Gillen's camp. Here, General Canby had agreed to meet with Captain Jack with the understanding that all participants would be unarmed. Canby passed out cigars. They began to smoke, and Canby began to speak.
"He said he had come there to make peace with them and to talk good," said Frank Riddle, who was translating at the time. "And whatever he promised to give them, he would make sure they got it."
After others in Canby's party spoke, it was Captain Jack's turn. "I do not want to leave this country. I know no other country than this." Suddenly, Captain Jack pulled a pistol and fired at Canby, who stood no more than 5 feet away. It misfired with a loud click. Canby did not move. Jack cocked and fired again, and Canby fell. Boston Charlie shot Peace Commissioner Reverend Ebenezer Thomas in the head, killing him instantly. Riddle ran for his life as bullets flew past his ears. Agent Leroy Dyer was also running, chased by Black Jim and Hooker Jim. They fired after him, but they missed. Scuncheon John chased after Meacham. He fired 6 shots, hit him 4 times, then left him for dead. Boston Charlie tried to scalp Meacham's nearly bald head, but when Toby Riddle, who had been pushed to the ground, shouted,
"Oh, the soldiers are coming! The soldiers are coming!"
Charlie and the rest of the MODOKs ran away. There were no approaching soldiers, but Toby's quick thinking had saved Meacham's life. 10 minutes earlier, 4.5 miles to the east, Lieutenant William Sherwood was officer of the day at Hospital Rock, manned by Colonel Mason's troops. 2 MODOKs had approached and stood 1/4 mile away with a white flag. Sherwood, accompanied by Lieutenant Boyle, went out to meet them. Private Charles Hardin, who was watching from above, saw Sherwood and Boyle suddenly turn and run back up the hill, the MODOKs firing after them. Boyle made it, but Sherwood was hit in the leg and fell. Hardin called to him, asking, "Are you badly hurt?" He said he was. Sherwood would linger for a few days and then die. While Sherwood's body was being recovered, Mason signaled to Gillam's camp that there was trouble, but it was too late. At about 10 minutes past noon, a signal came back from Gillam's camp. "General Canby, Dr. Thomas, and Meacham are killed." Within days, the army once again attacked the stronghold and found that Captain Jack and his band had escaped to the south. Captain Evan Thomas was ordered to head a patrol that would attempt to locate the MODOKs. This would be a major disaster. Thomas was accompanied by Lieutenant Thomas Wright. Both men were sons of Army generals, and both were inexperienced in fighting Indians. With them were four other officers, 66 troops, 14 Warm Springs Indian scouts. While resting in a flat area surrounded by 200-foot-high ridges, they were attacked by just 21 MODOKs, led by Scarface Charlie. Many of the troops began to scatter under the gunfire, some even dropping their rifles. Thomas, Wright, and most of the troops stood their ground and returned fire. Two-thirds of the patrol, including Thomas and Wright, would die. With the agonizing sounds of the wounded still echoing off the ridges, Scarface Charlie stood up and called out, "All you fellas that ain't dead down there better go home. We don't want to kill you all in one day." Another battle 2 weeks later at Sorice Lake forced the outnumbered MODOKs to flee to the east. Their morale was low, and there was friction over who had caused the defeat. "I quit my chief today," said Black Jim, "for I cannot fight by his side any more. I hate him from now on." Black Jim, along with Hooker Jim, Shacknasty Jim, Steamboat Frank, and Bogus Charlie, headed west, leaving Jack with only 30 men, women, and children. Many of these men had helped kill the settlers at the beginning of the war and had goaded Captain Jack into killing Canby. Now these very same men agreed to lead the army back to capture Jack's band.
"Their daring exploits and usefulness in capturing Captain Jack and the band have won the admiration of all of us," said General Jefferson Davis, who had replaced Canby. "Without them, Jack and the band might yet not been captured. Honor on my part requires me to exempt them from execution."
And they did not hang, even though they had killed the settlers. On June 1, 1873, southwest of Clear Lake, on the banks of remote Willow Creek, Captain Jack surrendered.
"The once proud chief of the MODOKs, the brave man, the honest man," Jeff Riddle said in his book, The Indian History of the MODOK War. "He was known by many white men to be proud, to be honest, and an upright man. But on that day he was captured, and captured by his own men, he felt degraded. His manhood left him. As he said, I am ready to die."
The night before he was to hang, Captain Jack was allowed to visit with his wives, Rebecca and Lizzie, and with his daughter, Rosie. "This young child, a little girl about 4 years of age, ran to her father, rending the air with frantic screams," wrote San Francisco Chronicle correspondent Henry Shaw. "Captain Jack extended both his arms to receive his infant daughter and, at the very same time, turned his head aside. For several minutes he maintained this position unchanged, embracing the child with averted head, yet his countenance gave no indication of the great emotion which must have been stirring his innermost soul. Neither of his wives spoke, not one word to him, in fact, from the time he entered until he was conducted back to his cell. Not one word passed between the condemned chieftain and his followers."
The federal government quietly removed the heads of the four hanged men and sent the skulls to Washington, D.C. for what they would call a scientific study. In 1984, a MODOK woman who lives in Klamath County retrieved the skulls and returned them to Oregon. She gave them a traditional, cultural, and hereditary burial in a designated area, an area she understandably refuses to divulge. Now, there are rumors that Captain Jack's headless body was taken up and put on display, and in fact, there is a newspaper report that says a Yreka, California undertaker, Mr. Sherwood, was planning to do just that. However, an order from Commanding General Schofield said that the MODOK bodies must not be mutilated after death. Ended Sherwood's show business dreams. Francis Landrum, a lifelong Klamath County resident and local historian, in his book Guardhouse, Gallows, and Graves, concluded after studying the exterior condition of the graves at Fort Klamath in 1984 that Captain Jack had indeed been buried. If Captain Jack's body was stolen, as has been alleged, in a ghoulish enterprise on that very first evening, Landrum wrote, a conspiracy of humongous proportions was carried out in full view of reporters, MODOK captives, guard details, and most important, in front of those Indians permitted freedom from the stockade, Scarface Charlie and the four bloodhounds, Hooker Jim, Bogus Charlie, Shacknasty Jim, and Steamboat Frank. It hardly seems possible. In 2011, scientists from the University of Oregon explored the graves with ground-penetrating radar at Fort Klamath. Kevin Fields, manager of the Fort Klamath Museum at the time, told me he was there and could plainly see the sharp edges of the graves and what appeared to be human remains at the bottom. Now, of course, none of that matters because, as we know, the rumors will continue on and on, no matter if they be true or false. On the evening of the hanging, Alfred Meacham, who had survived, spoke in San Francisco. In our wonderful progress, he said, we forget that our towns and our cities are built upon their homes and upon their graves. The few Indians who remain among us are looked upon with disgust, and the expression is not uncommon that the good Indians are all under the ground. We've written our side of the history and published it to the world. Their side lives only in their own hearts and in their graves. We open wide our gates to the oppressed of every nation, but still we have regarded these people as aliens and strangers. We have spent millions of dollars to educate the barbarians of other lands, and they are neglected. We have not been slow to punish them for crimes, but had suffered them to be robbed and to be murdered. Oh, how little, how very little we know of these people. To remember this war, we must rely on memories, sometimes remembered as long as a half century after the fact. There are words that are transcribed in 19th century shorthand and may or may not be accurately recorded. Words of MODOK Indians spoken in MODOK and sometimes, before being translated into English, are translated into Chinook jargon, a language concocted so whites and different tribes speaking different languages could all communicate with each other. If jargon was indeed the intermediary step, then it also had to be retranslated into spoken English, while a stenographer over there in the corner attempted to transcribe that translation. No tape recorders or videotapes, and lots of room for error. And then, of course, very little of what the MODOKs were saying even survives to this day. In truth, it's often impossible to separate fact from fiction. Some of our information comes from correspondence that often interprets events in the most favorable way for the writer, who usually is writing to a superior military officer or officials, and whose job could be on the line if the wrong thing was said or written. Then, of course, there are the newspapers, sometimes correspondents at the front, but more often, commentators and critics comfortably situated miles away and full of uninformed opinions. It is a common problem we face whenever we look back. As historian Simon Schama said, historians are left forever chasing shadows, painfully aware of their inability ever to reconstruct a dead world in its completeness. Yes, we are doomed to be forever hailing someone who has just gone around the corner and out of our earshot.
Thanks for watching. Hey, we'll see you real soon with something brand new. Now don't forget to subscribe and maybe give us a thumbs up. Have a great day and an even better tomorrow.